Proper lubrication, reducing friction and wear, and acting as a coolant, is vital to the operation of the diesel engine. Without a protective film of oil between the metal surfaces, friction would result in excessive temperatures and the seizure of moving parts. In a diesel engine of the common type illustrated by this diagram, lubricating oil is forced under pressure into this oil header or manifold. From here, individual leads carry the oil to each main bearing. Channels in the bearing surface distribute the oil evenly over its full width. Then passages drilled in the crankshaft lead the oil from the main bearing to the crank bearing. It then flows upward through a drilled passage in the connecting rod to the piston pin bearing. After lubricating the piston pin bearing, the oil drains out at either end. When the engine is in operation, the connecting rod and the crankshaft splash this oil over the cylinder walls, where it is evenly distributed by the oil control rings on the piston skirt. Excess oil, wiped from the cylinder wall by the lower oil control ring, drips back into an oil pan in the crankcase. Oil is also carried through small tubes and drilled passages to lubricate the camshaft bearings, push rods and rocker arms, gear trains and other assemblies and accessory units requiring lubrication. This oil also drains into the crankcase. The oil collected in the oil pan is recirculated through the engine. But since it now contains impurities and is too hot to provide adequate lubrication, it must first be purified and cooled. From the crankcase, the oil is led to a sump tank, where solid impurities such as carbon, rust, or metal particles are allowed to settle. The oil is drawn from this tank by a pump, usually a gear pump of the positive displacement type. The oil, entering the suction side, is trapped between the gear teeth and the pump housing. The rotating gears discharge the trapped oil at sufficient pressure to force it through the system. But first, the oil is pumped through a strainer. In the most common types, the oil is forced through the narrow spaces between a number of metal or paper discs. Impurities lodging in these spaces must be periodically removed to avoid clogging the strainer. The oil next passes through a heat exchanger or cooler, where it is cooled by seawater. Usually, the oil flows through a set of tubes around which the seawater circulates. The rate of flow can be regulated to control the rate of cooling. The heat exchanger may be bypassed in cold weather when the oil does not require cooling. The oil is now ready to re-enter the engine. Since the strainer and the settling process in the sump tank are frequently not sufficient to remove all impurities, the oil is generally also passed through a purifier. In this process, the oil is pumped from the sump tank, and after being thinned by heating, it is carried to a centrifuge. Here, water and any remaining solid impurities are whirled out by centrifugal force, and the purified oil is returned to the sump tank. To ensure good lubrication of all parts of the engine, the proper pressures and temperatures must be maintained throughout the system. A relief valve is used to protect the system from excessive pressures. A motor-driven auxiliary pump is often provided for priming the lube oil system before starting the engine. In general, most diesel engines have pressure lubrication systems of this type. In several engines, however, the lubricating oil is used for piston cooling as well. In the large General Motors submarine engine, the oil is sprayed from a nozzle at the end of the connecting rod onto the underside of the piston. In the HOR double-acting engine, the oil is circulated through the piston, entering and leaving through tubes in the piston rod. All engine parts exposed to the high temperatures of compression and combustion must be protected by cooling. This retains the strength of the metal and prevents undue expansion of parts and the rapid deterioration of the lube oil. In one type of cooling system, called the open system, seawater is circulated through the engine. Entering the system through a strainer in the sea chest, it passes through a sea valve and a stop valve to a twin strainer. Usually, the water is pumped through the system by a centrifugal pump. From the pump, the water is carried to the oil cooling heat exchanger. If the oil does not require cooling, as in starting or in cold weather, the water may be bypassed around this unit. In the air injection type of engine, where a compressor is used, the water next passes through the spray air coolers. From here, it is led to the air compressor cylinders and to the cylinders of the engine itself. Entering at the base of the cylinder water jackets, it cools the cylinder liner as it rises to the cylinder head. Having cooled the cylinder head with its valves and injector, the water passes through the water jacket surrounding the exhaust header. It may then be either discharged directly overboard or sprayed into the exhaust gases in the muffler. Pieces of zinc are placed in the sea chest, the heads of coolers, and at other convenient points to protect the piping and water jackets from the electrolytic action of seawater. In the closed type of cooling system, fresh water is circulated through the engine, avoiding the danger of scale deposit. The path of the cooling water is similar to that of the seawater in the open system. The pump forces it through the water jackets of the engine. From here, it flows to a heat exchanger, where the fresh water is cooled in turn by seawater. From the heat exchanger, the water returns to the pump, and the cycle is repeated. An expansion tank is located at the highest point on this line. A sight gauge mounted on the tank indicates the amount of water in the system. The makeup feed line for adding fresh water is located at the suction side of the pump. Pressure gauges and thermometers are placed at various points in the system. The seawater in the closed system enters at the sea chest. And after passing over zinc, it is pumped through the lubricating oil cooler and the fresh water cooler. It is then either sprayed into the muffler or is discharged directly overboard. Conveniently located valves allow for the control of the rate of flow through both heat exchangers. Before the engine is stopped, it should be run at reduced load in order to cool it gradually. Strict compliance at all times with operating instructions will increase the life of the engine parts and the efficiency of the engine under both normal and emergency loads, factors on which may depend the success of a naval mission.